I look amazing. See, this is what happens when you make ripples where you are. You stay hydrated. Okay, collarbone.
Hi. This week is all about how to make movies in the US, and my guest is doing that beautifully. She began her film career as a committee member of TIFF Next Wave in 2013. She then made her way to attend NYU's film and television program, where she directed her thesis short film, Shiva Baby. After its premiere at South by Southwest in 2018, Shiva Baby brought her back to TIFF Next Wave in 2019, this time as a filmmaker. She then adapted the short into a feature film, which premiered at this year's South by Southwest, to rave reviews. Here to talk about making it stateside, it's Emma Seligman.
Feels appropriate as a next step. And my dog is going off again. Dog is 16, and like he just is like, he barks when he wants to be carried. We keep saying like, it's Hershey's world, we just live in it.
Emma Seligman, a queen. I want to hear about your experience at NYU. You know, in my mind, I think it's like a Noah Baumbach movie or something.
It just came with quirks, you know, like the film parties were definitely like everyone smoking cigarettes and like just like being a little pretentious. But I'm sure you get that in every kind of film school arts community. What I gained the most from it was the community and the network of kids that I went to school with, which I think goes for every film school, but it's especially prominent in New York and at NYU. You're making so many shorts with your classmates, but then they're also making music videos and low budget commercials and other sort of experimental art form videos. So you kind of just are able to hop on set a lot and gain your skill set. I got to meet all of my peers that then, you know, I eventually brought on to my first feature.
I'm curious to know if there are any pros and cons that you noticed about being an emerging filmmaker in the US film system versus the Canadian one.
I think there's pros and cons from what I gather from both. I think that if you are emerging in the States as a filmmaker, you have to be able to be in a position, unfortunately, most of the time, where you know you're not going to get paid, you know that your peers aren't going to get paid, and you straddle between like three different jobs. I was a babysitter in my 2 years after graduating. And then on the Canadian side, I feel like there's a deep respect for filmmakers and talent, and the filmmaker friends that I have in Canada are like, I don't want to make this fair for me and my team. Like, I don't want to be working overtime and not getting paid for schlepping costumes. The first time I heard a friend of mine give that criticism, I was so shocked because I was so indoctrinated into the like American, like, work through the night and do it for free. And so that's a con. But the pro is that sometimes with that sort of like hustle and that fire under your ass, you can like, can you make it happen and kind of get everyone on board.
So I want to talk about Shiva Baby. It's online now on Vimeo. Everyone should go watch it. Can you give us a little insight about what the process of adapting that short to a feature was like?
I was really lucky that the short film got into South by Southwest 2 years ago. From that, we started to just galvanize support for the feature. We just reached out to everybody we knew and every young filmmaker we knew and tried to figure out who their financiers were. Once we got our first EP on board, who's this wonderful woman named Rhiannon Jones, who gives 50K investments to female filmmakers, first and second time female filmmakers, we just started collecting like smaller film investments from like so many people, and we just kind of like cobbled together this budget. Other than Rhiannon and I think two others, no one else had ever invested in a film before. So it ended up being like friends of friends of friends of my family friends or my producers or various cast members. It felt so weird to ask people for money for a film. I was like, wanna support? And they were like, will I get my money back? And I was like, I don't know. It was a weird hump I had to get over. And then after a while, it got a little more natural for me.
When researching Shiva Baby, the short, I noticed that all of your department heads were filled by women, which is amazing. What are some of the ways you think emerging marginalized creators in general can position themselves early on so that their credits and their career can consistently prioritize equity.
I felt with my crew, like I'd gotten to know a lot of them in school and they'd done a lot of favors for me and I'd done favors for them. And when it came to the first feature, I was like, I'm gonna work with the women I want to. I think that the best thing you can do to position yourself is just work with like-minded people, work with other female and marginalized community like filmmakers and storytellers, so that like that trust and that relationship is formed, and that if they get a feature, they'll bring you on. I think you have a little bit more agency when you're making your first feature if it's like really indie and scrappy like how ours was.
I wanted to ask, given the recent momentum with the Black Lives Matter movement right now, I'm curious to know how this movement has impacted you as a filmmaker.
I want to have a production company at some point where I can support other storytellers that didn't have the privilege I did to go to NYU. It's never too soon to start thinking about doing that and to start building relationships with filmmakers and storytellers that I want to support. I think that for a while I felt like, oh, well, like I've only made one feature and it was low budget and, you know, I don't have that much power. There's no too soon time to just start trying to think about that, especially while we're still in lockdown and can't film anything. I've just been trying to think of like how I can use my voice in an authentic way that's commenting on so many injustices in every industry without taking up too much space. So telling it from the right perspective.
It's not like you're necessarily sacrificing the story that you initially wanted to tell, but it's interesting that you're trying to highlight the things in that story that relate to the movement that's happening right now.
Totally, yeah. Like figuring out where you fall in the system and like where you can speak to and what you can relate to in the bad ways and good ways, and trying to tell a critical and authentic story from that perspective.
Thank you so much for this amazing chat.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate this.
Emma!
Thank you so much for being in my corner this week, and we'll see you next week for our last installment. Oh, wow. God, does that mean I can finally leave this corner?